Welcome to the Unitarian Universalist Church of Spokane, where our mission is to join together to create a nourishing, liberal religious home and to champion justice, diversity, and environmental stewardship in our wider world, or as we say in short, to create community, find meaning, and work for justice. Welcome to one and all. It's great to have you with us this morning. As always, I want to begin by welcoming all that you are, all that you bring with you, all of your uniqueness, everything that helps make you who you are is welcome here this morning. And we want to say a special welcome to those of you who might be joining us for the first time this morning. We're also glad to have you, as well as those who've been joining us from around the country since we've been streaming our services, particularly during the COVID-19 shutdown. It's great to know that you're with us too. So I like the idea of creating using technology to help create a global community, because that's what we are. So welcome to one and all, near and far. Great to have you today. Speaking of near, there's lots of folks in the room here I want to welcome. This, by the way, is the fourth move for this particular service. We've tried it, I think, this is the third time we've actually tried it, but we've had to reschedule it four times. So if you're fatalistic, you might think the fates are working against us, but it's certainly not the most controversial sermon I've ever given, so hopefully it's been worth the wait. But anyway, it's great to have everyone in the room here with us, especially to have you back for this successful attempt at doing this at the right moment. So this must be it. So I want to welcome Candace Schmidt, who is back with us as our lay leader this morning. Thank you so much for your flexibility. You had some great readings that accompanied this service just perfectly, so I'm glad you could come back and be with us this morning. Michalina Tyree is on the piano. Thank you. Always great to have you with us. Yep, and off to my right, your left, is Kelly LaGruda and Peggy Eckloff, who are going to be performing for us again. By the way, those of us in the room got to hear all of this because we didn't know we weren't on the air. So we actually went through the entire service, so we get to participate in it again. But you're in for a real treat today. The music is and songs are spectacular. So thanks both of you for being back here as well. No pressure, she says. And of course, Sonny Cook is back here working our slideshow. Hey, we got them working. Just in the nick of time. All right. We were having a little bit of issue with that, so glad we have our slides. Thank you for your patience. And of course, Todd Milne working our audio visual. Thank you so much for being here so faithfully, and also for always sharing your music with us too, Todd. That's an added bonus for sure. So let's see, a couple of announcements. One, as hopefully most or many of you know, because I've been talking about it a lot, I've been working on a new book called The Gadfly Affair. It is a book about all that has transpired, particularly the first year following the release of the Gadfly Papers, my release of the Gadfly Papers at the General Assembly in 2019. Everything from the initial banning to the excommunication about a year later. So I wanted to get these happenings on the record, and the book includes appendixes that are actually lengthier than the book itself, so that all these documents are actually preserved and historians can look at them. You can look at them for yourself and kind of see what communications actually transpired and what didn't. But I want to give you the opportunity as a congregation to hear more from me about the book, answer any questions you might have. So we're going to have a couple of meetings coming up in the near future, I should say, particularly the first starting this Thursday evening at 6 p.m. to 7:30 p.m. 6 p.m. to 7:30 p.m. That's an evening meeting for those who prefer to do so in the evening. And then we're going to have one the following Wednesday, not this Wednesday, but the following Wednesday on February 3rd, in the afternoon from 2 p.m. to 2:30. You've actually already gotten those links and notification of that meeting, and we'll have them again in your church email. But wanted to alert you to that. Those are the two opportunities to talk with me for a bit about my next entry into the conversation of what I consider a vital topic for the survival of our liberal religion. So put those dates on your calendar and participate if you are interested. And finally, social hour following our service, as always. You should be able to find that link as well in your UUCS email that went out to you earlier this week. So, again, thanks and welcome. And I invite all of you now to take a few moments at the start of our service, as usual, by greeting one another virtually, however you have become accustomed to doing that. Thank you so much, and as always, I do hope that you will continue to stay in touch with each other throughout the week. We see a light at the end of this long pandemic tunnel, but it is not over yet, and we still need to stay connected. So thanks for all you're doing to help one another during this period. We are going to move forward now with our service by lighting our chalice, the symbol of our faith, the symbol of our unity and our solidarity, of our openness and our inclusion of our community and our individual uniqueness. May this small flame be our offering of warmth to those who are cold and alone, and a light to those in darkness. May it be a flame that ignites justice in our world and a beacon of hope to those in need. And may it reflect at least a spark of truth wherever truth has been lost, and cast a healthy shadow of doubt wherever it's been found.
Nelson Mandela once said, "If you talk to a man in a language he merely understands, that goes to his head. If you talk to him in his own language, that goes to his heart." He was so right, says Trevor Noah in his book, Born a Crime. When you make the effort to speak someone else's language, even if it's just basic phrases here and there, you are saying to them, "I understand that you have a culture and identity that exists beyond me. I see you as a human being."
Thank you, Candace. We're now going to kindle our candles of care for those who are most on our hearts and minds this morning. And I did get word just yesterday that church member David Eagle and church treasurer David Eagle's mother passed away after dealing with COVID just a couple of days ago. So we want to keep David and his entire family in our thoughts at this time. Let's do take a moment on behalf of others that you might be thinking of. And again, wherever you are, with whomever you are, you're welcome to share those names aloud. those named aloud and those embraced in our silence, and all those who are suffering in our world at this hour, we hold in our community with compassion. We do have a special collection this month, and I think it's a very timely special collection. Even though homelessness is unfortunately, sadly, a chronic problem in our society, it is particularly bad at this time in history. And so it's, I think, very valuable for us as a congregation to do what we can to help impact this problem, particularly in our own community. So our special collection is actually going to go to support various organizations in our community that are working to assist with this problem. So those that are providing shelter and meals and health services, as well as other services to the homeless, including Hope House, Crosswalk, Shalom Ministries, and Stevens providing meals for the kids at Stevens Elementary. So in addition to your financial donations, which we'll be collecting throughout the rest of the month, there is also a container outside of our front door during the day, during business hours, office hours. So if you have any kind of winter gear, winter clothing that you might be willing to donate, that will be out there for you as well. So as always, you can contribute by check, making it out to the church here, UUCS, and sending it in. Just be sure and put what it's for on the memo line. The date will be fine, or January special collection. Or you can go online to our donations button and navigate to the special collections as well, and just indicate again there what it is for. So thanks again for your tremendous generosity to help with this particular issue in our community. We are now going to have our story for all ages. So gather around. Hey, looky here. My goodness. This is a brand new friend that I just became acquainted with a couple of days ago. So, in fact, I didn't even get your name.
I don't think I want to tell you.
Well, I guess you're still just a little upset with me, aren't you?
I'm not upset. I just don't like rude people.
I guess I should explain. Peggy came home from the store the other night and asked me to help get the groceries out of the car.
Is that what you call it?
Well, and when I opened the door, there was this large iguana on the seat.
And you were horrified.
Well, you know, I got to explain. It was just because it was a little dark and I wasn't exactly expecting to see a large iguana, so yes, I was a little startled.
Just a little?
Well, it was, you know, again, I might have said a choice word or two, but once I realized what was going on, I did invite you into the house, didn't I?
And would you have been as startled if I was a cute little kitten?
Tell you what, Why don't we start all over again? My name is Todd. It's really nice to meet you. What is your name? Well, okay, if you're not going to tell me your name, why don't I try to give it a guess?
This should be interesting.
Okay. Well, let's see. I'm going to guess it's Iggy. Iggy the iguana.
Really? Are you hooked on phonics? Iggy the iguana?
Okay, why don't you just tell me what your name is?
It's Donna.
Donna?
Donna.
Donna the iguana.
I know. It's almost as unimaginative as Iggy.
Yes, well, anyway, it's nice to meet you, Donna, and again, I'm really sorry for the misunderstanding.
It was dark, I suppose, and iguanas are used to being misunderstood.
Well, why don't you just try telling us a little bit about yourself and about iguanas in general to help us get to know you a little bit better.
Above all, iguanas love sun.
You love the sun. Well, there's a lot of people here in Spokane who can relate because they love the sun too, especially this time of year. What else?
Well, we can live longer than those dogs, sometimes more than 20 years, and can grow as long as 6 feet.
Wow, that is a long time and a lot of feet.
Well, it's mostly tail.
I'll bet it is. But what else makes iguanas special?
We love trees. We love to climb trees, to eat in trees, and to sleep in trees on hot days.
Oh, okay. Well, you know, I'm going to be talking a little bit later about a man who climbed up in a tree so he could look over a large crowd.
I like your story already.
His name was Zacchaeus, and like you, he was also often misunderstood.
Were people afraid of him too?
Well, they were certainly prejudiced against him, which means they didn't like him, even though nobody ever really talked to him or got to know him or even asked him any questions about himself.
That's a really sad story. I don't think I want to hear any more.
Well, it does have a happy ending.
In that case, go ahead.
Well, a man named Jesus, who was respected by everyone, approached the tree and said, "Hey, Zach, come on down. I want to spend the entire day with you."
He was very nice.
Well, yes, he was. And when others saw how kind he was to poor, misunderstood Zacchaeus, some of them realized how wrong they had been about him and about how many others they disliked without ever trying to get to know them.
And did he like Zacchaeus?
Well, it turns out that Zacchaeus was very generous and just wanted to be understood and included like everyone else.
And was he understood and included like everyone else?
Well, not by everyone, but some people were mad at Jesus for being so nice to a person that they disliked, but others realized how wrong it had been to be so judgmental, especially without ever getting to know where he was coming from.
That's a good story. I guess iguanas and humans have some things in common after all.
Well, most of us do, if we'll just take time to get to know each other. And today, I'm glad you came down from your tree and we got to know you, Donna the iguana.
Good hanging out with you, Todd. Almost as much as hanging out in a tree on a hot day.
Well, thanks for the compliment, Donna the iguana. See you next time.
Jack Cornfield. Buddhist monks begin each day with a chant of gratitude for the blessings of their life. Native American elders begin each ceremony with grateful prayers to Mother Earth and Father Sky, to the four directions, to the animal, plant, and mineral brothers and sisters who share our earth and support our life. In Tibet, the monks and nuns even offer prayers of gratitude for the suffering they have been given. You are invited to reflect on all the people and things you are grateful for.
Our reading today is actually the story of Zacchaeus the tax collector from Luke 19, although it is my own rendition of the story. When Jesus was passing through Jericho, a rich man named Zacchaeus, who was the town's chief tax collector, wanted to get a better look at him. Being short in stature, he ran ahead of him and climbed a tree so he could see above the large crowd. When Jesus reached the tree, he looked up and said, "Zacchaeus, come down immediately. I want to stay at your house today." The excited tax collector came down and happily welcomed him. Some in the crowd started to grumble. "He's gone to be the guest of a sinner." But Zacchaeus told Jesus, "I'm giving half of my possessions to the poor right now, and I'll give four times the amount to anyone I've ever cheated." Jesus told the crowd, "This is a good house because it belongs to a man who is Jewish, just like the rest of you. Helping those who are lost is what I'm all about."
Good morning. When I asked Kelly if she wanted to say something about this song, she said, "Well, every songwriter has written a song during the COVID." But honestly, sitting at her kitchen table, the first time I read the words to this, I sobbed because I thought it was so beautiful. So it's called "Until Then."
Again, no pressure.
No pressure.
More.
And we will sing.
With any scrap of luck, we'll dance, and all the joy we'll bring.
These days are not the end, but the ones we're living in, they'll surely pass again. But until then, they will surely pass again. But until then, until then, until then, when the sorrow between us will lay to rest again, until then.
lay to rest again. Until then, my friend, oh, until then, I will hold you in my heart. Until then, I will hold you in my heart. I can't wait until then.
Thank you, Peggy and Kelly. That was great, and well worth hearing a third time, I think, at least for some of us. I'm reminded of, for those who remember the Gong Show, which hosted by Chuck Barish, you know, a lot of you probably don't, but when I was a kid, it was a kind of like America's Got Talent, only with some really B-grade talent. And there was a fella that must have been on every week for 6 months to dressed as Abraham Lincoln. He was going to give the Gettysburg Address. And every time he started to come on, Chuck Barris would say, "I'm sorry, we've run out of time. Can you come back next week?" So this went on for 6 months. Finally, he gets to give his speech, and he gets gonged and pulled off the stage before he finished. So I hope that is not indicative of my sermon today. And I hope that it's been worth waiting for. So Zacchaeus come down. Some of you have heard me get through at least a portion of it. But it's subtitled Welcoming the Collaborators Among Us. And I want to begin by using the analogy of war, of warfare, when it's often difficult to distinguish between the good guys and the bad guys just by looking at their actions, right? Because behaviorally, both sides look a lot alike. Both are convinced that they are killing and dying for a just and righteous cause. Both use extreme violence as a means to achieve their ends. And both are usually fighting over an ideology they believe will become the established truth by proving themselves victorious. Truth is considered among the spoils of war that go to the victors. It's incredible to think about the violence and fog of war in these terms as the most extreme and brutal expression of a common logical fallacy ad baculum, which is the mistaken notion that might makes right. The same fallacy that parents commit when telling a questioning child, "because I said so," is the same one responsible for the invention of the atomic bomb and the proliferation of nuclear weapons. It's also the fallacy, I believe, responsible for the insane level of division in our society today. When I was born in 1964, and throughout my childhood, the Cold War between the U.S. and Russia was in full force, and the very real threat of nuclear war was the world's greatest fear. In those days, capitalism and communism were the two ideologies the ad baculum fallacy was being committed over, and the planet's two most powerful nations were willing to destroy everything for. But when the Cold War ended in the 1980s, this might makes right fallacy was turned toward other Americans within the U.S., toward the same internal enemy that had been its focus before the Civil War, before the Cold War began. Liberals. That's when the Reagan administration eliminated the Fairness Doctrine, requiring those companies granted broadcast licenses to present various positions on an issue. He also deregulated the industry, making it possible for corporations to start buying up as many news stations and papers and magazines in one market as they wanted. And this resulted in the emergence of Rush Limbaugh and Fox News. Such entities couldn't have existed prior to those changes. And eventually, they occur to all of our mainstream media, becoming propagandistic and being controlled by what is today only five corporations, something you hear me talk about a lot. We now have two generations, at least two generations, that have grown up watching news programs, reading magazines, and more recently browsing social media echo chambers that present biased information with certainty, while also using their platforms to attack those whom they disagree with. That's largely what we see on the news today. Newscasters attacking those with whom they disagree. It's not normal. Maybe it's become normal, but it's not normal. That's what the news has become. It's become ideological warfare. And that's another form of the ad baculum fallacy, thinking that we must be right if we can convince others of it, even if by force, spin, lies, and manipulation. And now, almost 40 years since all of this began, our nation is more polarized than perhaps since the Civil War. And extremist thinking that determines truth by force rather than with reason and evidence has become our national epistemology. Whether the ideologues consider themselves conservative or liberal has become inconsequential, both because both are behaviorally the same, right? If ideas are the only difference, is there really any difference? They both destroy their ideological enemies by using mass media technologies to demonize and discredit them, and they do so with no duty to objectivity and facts. They may differ slightly in the sense that conservatives tend to believe that theirs is the only truth, and postmodern liberals that there is no such thing as truth, so one truth is just as good as another. But in the end, both cling to the supremacy of their truth by forcing them upon others. Behaviorally, they are the same. The problem all of us face when it comes to truth is that we can't be absolutely certain of anything. The kind of extremism that leads to warfare and ideological intolerance is an unhealthy response to our innate dread of uncertainty. It is a way of coping with the problem by ignoring or suppressing anything counter to our chosen beliefs. With no opposition, we wrongly infer that we must be right. I believe such behavior is part of our biological survival instinct, as it is for all creatures. Life survives or perishes by repetition. Fatal mistakes are seldom made twice, or they wouldn't be fatal. Repeating behavior that doesn't get them killed is what shapes the bodies and behaviors of any species. Repetition is how evolution happens. Humans are no different except for our ability to think about what we think about. We just apply the repetitive instinct to what we believe. If an idea doesn't get us killed, we keep repeating it. We feel sure about it, secure in it, and threatened by anything or anyone who might cause us to think differently about things, because thinking differently, we intuit, might get us killed. We're afraid of differences. The information in our genes wants to survive our death by getting passed on to new host organisms, so we are biologically wired to stay with the tried and with the true. Neurologically, our brains are wired to fear new things. Fear isn't like other emotions. It has a physical structure in our heads called the amygdala, which is always on the lookout for unknown dangers, making us instinctively neophobic, afraid of the new. For us thinking animals, this includes being afraid of new ideas. This is probably why we teach our kids to be aware of strangers, and why so many cultures throughout history have been more or less xenophobic, because foreigners represent strange ideas and strange ways. Being sure that our way is the right way and that our beliefs are the right beliefs helps us cope with this dread of uncertainty. And this is why, according to Your Brain at Work by David Rock, the brain actually craves certainty, because a sense of uncertainty about the future and feeling out of control both generate strong limbic system responses. Uncertainty causes us to be afraid, which causes us to feel threatened. And on being certain, neurologist Robert Burton similarly tells us that the feeling of certainty, which he considers an emotion as primary as anger and fear, releases dopamine into our pleasure centers. Feeling certain releases dopamine, a dopamine reward, to our pleasure centers. Might the know-it-all personality trait, he asked, be seen as an addiction to the pleasure of the feeling of knowing? If the science is correct, that we are biologically and neurologically wired to feel certain of our beliefs, even without any sound reasons for those beliefs, it would explain why our society, like so many throughout human history, has drifted so far toward intolerance and delusional thinking. As bad as such tribalism is, however, it is no more so than the internal intolerance occurring within our tribes today. If their members don't repeat the party line and status quo, they are quickly and harshly dealt with. In other words, it's no longer conservative against liberal or liberals against conservatives, but liberals against liberals and conservatives against conservatives. There is no room anywhere for honest discussion anymore, disagreement, or even curiosity. Don't ask questions, even of your friends. Last month, after Donald Trump began touting, or I should say 2 months ago now, sorry, I should scratch that out. It's been 2 months since I wrote this sermon. I should have updated that. Yeah, Donald Trump's no longer around. 2 months ago, after Donald Trump began touting delusional claims of mass voter fraud, some viewers became outraged when a certain television host complained the outgoing president's attorney, Sidney Powell, had not provided a shred of evidence to support her outlandish claims and had even told him to stop contacting her. The personality I'm talking about is Fox News host and conservative darling Tucker Carlson. Even though during the same broadcast, he also said that he was keeping an open mind on the matter, which is actually a closed mind, and actually encouraged viewers to trust the president's other attorney, Rudy Giuliani, about it, many viewers responded in outrage, calling Tucker a traitor and a sellout, just because he wanted facts. On the liberal side of things, just 2 nights ago, I did update this. Just 2 nights ago, a guest on HBO's Real Time with Bill Maher accused Maher of sounding a lot like the former conservative Speaker of the House, Paul Ryan, to which Maher responded, "Is that wrong?" To answer your question, no, I'm not Paul Ryan. But if I agree with him on something, it wouldn't make me a horrible person, would it? There's that argument. Oh, you sound like someone from the red team. You must be wrong. Marr is right. Presuming anyone we disagree with is wrong, if they are on the wrong side simply because they are on the wrong side, has become the norm in our country. Regardless of which side you're on, and not only ideologically wrong, but you're treated as fundamentally morally wrong. Just consider what happened to me after giving away my book of dissenting views regarding the direction, the illiberal direction, that our liberal religion is heading. And all the name-calling and ostracization that immediately began to transpire. Perhaps the worst of which were those Unitarian Universalist ministers who compared me to the Nazis in Charlottesville. With no intervention, even though it was set on a site moderated by the Unitarian Universalist Ministers Association, which soon thereafter censured me in a letter calling me a white supremacist. I also think of Americans like Daniel Ellsberg, who was charged with espionage after releasing the top secret Pentagon papers to the public in 1971 that proved damning of our government's activities in Vietnam. More recently, Edward Snowden, who in 2013 exposed classified documents disclosing the NSA's widespread surveillance programs, which included spying on some of our private phone calls, Yahoo and Google accounts, and countless emails of millions of Americans. Like Ellsberg, Snowden had been called a traitor and is charged with violating the Espionage Act of 1917, and he's been in asylum ever since. There's also Chelsea Manning, who in 2013 was tried, convicted, and imprisoned under the same act for her involvement in the WikiLeaks release of sensitive military documents indicating the government's mishandling of certain foreign affairs, resulting in disastrous and deadly consequences. In all of these cases, the national news media and most of the private conversations I heard focused on the character of these individuals rather than the contents of the material they made available. As with all logical fallacies, these ad hominem conversations got us all off track about what was most important. The character of individuals like Ellsberg, Snowden, Manning, and Julian Assange, Tucker Carlson, Paul Ryan, Bill Maher, and Todd Eckloff, for that matter, have no bearing on the truth or falsehood of the information they have exposed. They must endure, we must endure, the consequences of our choices. Who they are and what happens to them will make no difference to the rest of us. What can make a difference, however, is the knowledge that they have revealed to us should we decide to pay attention to it. But what seems to matter more in our society is which team a person is playing for, not the truth or untruth of what they have to say. Politics and opinion in our nation has become little more than a team sport, with fans on both sides who despise those on the other. It doesn't matter whether the team plays by the rules or not, because winning is everything. The hosts on Fox News and MSNBC are like drunken fans on the sidelines hurling insults at the referees for issuing legitimate penalties against their team while cheering every foul issued against the other. Whether their team cheats to win or is fairly beaten is inconsequential to their opinion. Anything less than their team, their tribe, their side, their ideas winning is considered the worst kind of evil. And the referees who cry foul against them are the worst kind of villains. They are considered traitors, conspiring against the home team. But truth is not determined by breaking the rules of reason, or by force, or decree, or desire, or by killing the messenger, or by how many are on our side. Nor is falsehood determined by those who are against us. Jesus is the first wisdom teacher I know of to have countered this common notion. Think about it, this notion has been around a long time, right? This common notion that if you are not for us, then you are against us. By stating its exact opposite. If you are not against us, you are for us. It's an extraordinary insight that just because others don't think like us doesn't make them our enemy. So long as they are not actively working to harm us, they are not the opposition, no matter what they believe. It was such openness towards the outcast of his society, including those who had been unofficially demonized, or I should say officially demonized, by the authorities, that makes the historical Jesus such a compelling and inspiring figure to this day. He publicly socialized with those considered unclean, sinners, demonized, foreigners among us, putting his own reputation at stake by doing so. But one particular group of people that he was criticized for including at his welcome table belonged to a group that doesn't get much attention these days, the tax collectors. Nobody likes taxes, but why was it considered immoral to socialize with them? In their book, Excavating Jesus, about what we can infer from the archaeological evidence about the historical Jesus, John Dominic Crossan and Jonathan Reed tell us that the term tax collectors or toll collectors indicates those who collaborate with the local or imperial oppressors and or operate with excessive force, bribery, and corruption. What the complaints against them don't tell us, however, is that they were themselves Jews who worked in the service of the Roman authorities to exploit their own people. In other words, they were considered traitors in cahoots with the other side. It's easy to understand why some might frown upon Jesus' willingness to socialize with them, but Jesus seems to have understood the tremendous gap in his society between the top 1 to 2% who controlled 50 to 70% of its wealth and power, depended heavily upon getting others to do their dirty work. For this reason, it was nearly impossible for the members of the lower classes to ever have direct interactions with the ruling elite. Instead, they encountered members of what are called the retainer class, usually other Jews who were desperate to escape abject destitution to exploit and tax peasantry, which made up most of the population. As theologian William Herzog explains, one of their roles was to shield elites from popular violence and resentment directed against the exploitive and oppressive practices of the elites. Although retainers worked in military and priestly roles, their most important functions were to identify the surplus produced by peasants, artisans, and other villagers, and to transfer it to the control of the ruler. They were the agents of redistribution in the economy. So even though they were themselves Jewish, they were surviving by upholding the oppressive system established by their Roman colonizers. Taking this system into account, Jesus' parables often did the unthinkable for those days by eliminating the retainer class from the story, getting rid of them, and placing the elite in direct contact with those they exploited. Most of his parables, if you go back and look at them, are economic in nature. And there is one parable, however, that is about how the retainers themselves, like the tax collectors and other go-betweens, are themselves victims of the system. It's usually referred to as the parable of the bags of gold. But Herzog says that it is really about the vulnerability of whistleblowers. In the story, a wealthy man gives 5 bags of gold to one servant, 2 to another servant, and 1 bag of gold to a third servant, which they are responsible for while he goes off on a long journey. When he returns from who knows where, because the ruling elite are never seen by ordinary people, they're always gone, the master asked his servants to account for his gold. And the first 2 had put the gold to work and ended up doubling his money, which made him pleased to no end. He rewarded them by putting them in charge of even more of his wealth. But the third man simply buried the 1 bag of gold he'd been given until his master returned. "Master," he said, "I know that you are a hard man, harvesting where you have not sown and gathering where you have not scattered seed. So I was afraid and went out and hid your gold in the ground. See, here is what belongs to you." The master was furious. "You wicked, lazy servant," he shouted, "you knew that I harvest where I have not sown and gather where I have not scattered seed. You should have put my money on deposit with the bankers so that when I returned, I would have received it back with interest." Of course, the servant knew that the master unethically made his money from fields he doesn't sow or seed, exploiting those who do by giving them loans that they depended on and charging them 100% interest. For the third servant to point this out by openly stating his master didn't do anything to deserve his wealth and refused to participate in the exploitation of others was as foolhardy as it was courageous. Throw that worthless servant outside the master commands into the darkness where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth, where he'll be miserable. Cast him out. Being ousted, imprisoned, and otherwise excluded is the usual fate of those who betray the unjust systems they are entrusted to uphold. People like Daniel Ellsberg, Edward Snowden, and Chelsea Manning. Jesus knew this, which is why he didn't hold anything against those who had little choice but to participate in such injustice or end up like the third man, whose truth-telling and non-cooperation ruined what would be left of what was likely to become his very short life. This explains the story of Zacchaeus, who is said to have been the chief tax collector, which made him better off than most he lived among. Being short in stature, he climbed a sycamore tree in order to get a better look at Jesus, who was surrounded by a large crowd. But Jesus approached the tree and said, "Zacchaeus, come down immediately. I must stay in your house today." This would have been quite a shocker to the crowd, Jesus receiving hospitality from a man whose wealth had been achieved by exploiting the misfortune of others. But Jesus knew Zacchaeus and others like him had little choice but to participate in the system or else suffer the miserable, if not deadly, consequences. Many of us take pride in embracing those who have been exploited and despised in our society, especially those whose oppression has been based on matters of identity like race, gender, and sexuality. But how many of us are willing to associate with the traitors among us? With those who have taken advantage of the system to avoid being crushed by it? Or those who have betrayed the system, the systems we feel so certain of, by exposing the faults in our own thinking? How many of us would not only include them at our welcome table, but be the willing guest at theirs? As guests, we would have to listen to them and hear things from their perspective, and to establish a genuine relationship that might lead us to care for one another. Just as the encounter in the gospel prompted Zacchaeus to begin giving away his wealth to the poor. Edward Snowden, come down. I want to hear what you have to say. Chelsea Manning, come down. I want to understand your point of view. Tucker Carlson, come down. I want to sit at your welcome table. Trump voter, come down. I want to be your friend. Liberal, come down. I want to learn more than I already know. Exploiter, come down. I want to not know why you feel so desperate. Foreigner, come down. I want to learn your ways. Stranger, come down. I want to learn something new. Gadfly, come down. I want to know why your words are so biting. Dissenter, come down. I want my ideas challenged. Whistleblower, come down. I want to see why you have risked so much to expose. Today, ideological intolerance and our biological need for certainty are dividing the human family in ways from which our society may not soon recover. But if, as John Locke once said, toleration is to be the chief characteristic mark of the true church, it is our task as Unitarians to push past the crowd, past the noise and pressure of groupthink, and approach the misunderstood individual hanging out there alone on a limb and say, come down immediately. Let us welcome one another. Thank you.
Join us in singing This Little Light of Mine. It's number 118 if you have a hymnal, but I think the words are a little different and they're on the screen.
I'll hit the right notes in a minute.
Shine.
reality is not to change people, but to offer them space where change can take place. It is not to bring men and women over to our side, but to offer freedom not disturbed by dividing lines. It is not to lead our neighbor into a corner where there are no alternatives left, but to open a wide spectrum of options for choice and commitment. It is not an educated intimidation with good books and good works, but the liberation of fearful hearts so that words can find roots and bear ample fruit. J.M. Nguyen. Amen, blessed be, salam aleikum, and shalom.
A secret chord that David played, and it pleased the Lord. But you don't really care for music, do you? It goes like this: the fourth, the fifth, the minor fall, the major lift, a baffled king composing hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Well, maybe there's a God above, but all I ever learned from love was how to shoot at somebody who outdrew you. It's not a cry you can hear in the night, and it's not somebody who's seen the light. It's a cold, it's a broken hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Say I took a name in vain. I don't even know the name. And if I did, well, really, what's it to you? There's a blaze of light in every word, and it doesn't matter which you heard, the holy or the broken. Hallelujah, hallelujah. I did my best. It wasn't much. I couldn't feel, so I tried to touch. I told the truth, I didn't come to fool you. Even though it all went wrong, I will stand before the Lord of Song with nothing on my lips but hallelujah, 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 hallelujah.